हेलो संध्या, इट्स
गुड
सो
मॉर्निंग
वेरी नाइस
अमोल।
टू मीट यू अगेन दिस वे.
यस सेम हियर।
या एंड वी आर हियर टुडे टू अंडरस्टैंड फ्रॉम ईच अदर हाउ COVID-19 सिचुएशन हैज अफेक्टेड अस एंड इन आवर रिस्पेक्टिव फील्ड्स व्हिच इज कॉमन एजुकेशन एंड द
यस
चिल्ड्रंस वर्ल्ड व्हाट वी कैन mutually, suggest to each other so that their world remains beautiful as it should be. Okay. These last few weeks have been very, very impactful for me, at least in Dubai, because I'm dealing mostly with expats. And because I'm exposed to a lot of data, some of the data that has come in front of me is really disturbing. OECD, okay, and World Bank has put into a public domain data that about 1.5 billion children right now in about 100 odd countries are sitting at home away from their school in the middle of their academic year because those countries and societies have been affected by COVID. That's a very, very large number. In fact, the number is bigger than the population of India, just to underline the enormity of the problem. And already, with so much of disparity between the education standards and the opportunities for learning that children world over have, it has put in a co some of the experts are saying that the world and the equity and equality of learning that children were exposed to has been pushed back by almost a decade or so. World had worked a lot to bring the children from different societies on an even keel, and that entire work has been pushed back by about a decade. Okay. Of course, technology is trying to do something in that regard, but right now, what is happening worldwide is firefighting. Societies have been affected, and the sub-element of any society is the family. It has been severely affected. And the least recognized but the most important component of the family is the child, with whom you and me deal regularly, has been severely impacted but unrecognized by the society and the people around them, perhaps in some respect. So because you are peculiarly placed because you directly interact with a lot of families and children, how do you think the families have been impacted by the pandemic? And what should be the way forward for the families?
So before I respond to you, Amol, I wish to take just this one moment to acknowledge something. We are in the midst of an incredible moment in the world, a moment of grief and a moment of deep gratitude. So at this moment, when there are so many of our brothers and sisters struggling in many parts of the world, I feel deepest gratitude that you and I can sit here in the comfort of our homes to be able to talk about the little people who are so special in our hearts, our children.
True.
And in the context of COVID, I have often heard in the press and in stories how our elderly are most vulnerable to the disease. And I wish to turn our attention to the most fragile, the most tender, and in my mind, also the most vulnerable of us, the children. While they probably are not most vulnerable to the disease itself, they are perhaps most vulnerable to this environment in which they today live. And when you give me this number of 1.6 billion children rendered schoolless at this moment, I think what is happening to the children is that everything they knew as life, rhythms of life, going to school, going to the garden, coming back home, you know, all the rhythms of life as they knew it has been taken away.
Yeah.
In a way, it's like the ground beneath their feet is taken away. And they're trying to make meaning out of this new picture that they have in front of them.
Sandhya, please repeat, because I think we lost your signal for a bit.
Yeah, I was just saying that, you know, what they are perhaps living with is a question of, am I safe? And what is going to happen to this world around me? And in that sense, I think a lot has happened in the landscape of children, which I think as societies, as individuals, as educators, as teachers, and as parents, we must bring our attention to and hold that question very deeply. Because mm-hmm. it's not as if we have the answers, but it's important that at this moment that we are holding this question and this space for our children.
So what will you recommend to the families? I mean, I know that there can't be one size fit all kind of situation here, but what would be your general recommendations to the families around us?
Yeah, I think families have also transformed over this time. And there was once a time where families were extended families. And in families, we had grandmother, grandfather. We were large families, especially in India. And today we are nuclear families. And this situation of being isolated from the world mm-hmm. makes us feel even more intense in this context of the nuclear family that we are placed in today.
Mm.
And the wisdom bridges, which Beloved Daji often talks about, which mm. we had with the generations before, mm. now most of us are cut off from that. And I think we feel the sadness of this current time even more than we have felt in the past. And therefore, I think it's a moment for us to acknowledge that it's not easy for families. Mm-hmm. And children come from different kinds of families. In our school, we always said, children who are loved in their families come to school to learn. And children who don't find that love in their families come to school so that they can be loved. Mm-hmm. So we have different kinds of families. And there are families that even in this moment are able to keep the harmony, keep the spirit of positive energy, of optimism and hope, because they are functional, stable, harmonious families. And we also know in this world that there are so many families which are struggling to be families. And therefore, what happens to children in those environments who have to breathe in that mood and energy all the time? And I think that is something that brings me to a point of sadness, maybe. Mm-hmm. What is the plight of these children? And for those of us who are trying to make sense of this time for our own children, I think there are many things we can do, but maybe I just share a little bit of what I am doing as a parent, more mm-hmm. than even as an educator, that mm-hmm. I find in my own home with my children. What has been a gift from these times is that in India, most of us are a bit disconnected from life processes, from cooking, from cleaning, making our beds, washing our toilets. These are activities that we have sort of outsourced to this beautiful community of helpers whom we don't have today. And so our children are now engaged with all of this. More than they have ever done in their own entire lives. And I can be honest about it. And I find it so nourishing in a way, mm-hmm. Not really as a chore, but really as connection to life. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a gift that we all can give our children, because they can participate with us in the process of living, which is all of this beautiful work. And I also find rituals that each family can have as very important, very meaningful. For instance, in our home, we have this small ritual where before bedtime, at prayer time, we have this question of what are we grateful for today? Mm-hmm. And sometimes my children tell me that they are grateful for the washing machine because for 3 days we didn't have the washing machine, or they're grateful for the akka who used to cook for us every day. So these are moments, I think, when families can come together and keep their living connection alive make time for conversations, to be there really for each other. And in that sense, perhaps this is a gift of so much time for each other.
So let me take you back a bit, because you mentioned that school was a very integral part of child's life till few weeks ago. Okay, now the school has been suddenly cut off because no child is coming to the school physically. So how are you bridging that gap now from the school side? How are your teachers helping the children to cope up with the new situation that they find themselves in?
So, you know, at this point, I wish to share that I come from a tradition of the world of pedagogy, where our endeavor is to protect the child and protect the forces of the child. And that also means protection from technology until now. And now we are at this threshold moment where technology seems to be the only perhaps tool that's available to connect all of us. And therefore, as a school, while we have not gone online in terms of class situation, because we're in India, it's summer holidays, we have started connecting with our parents with different questions. Firstly, we ran a survey with our parents to understand what is their need, really. Do parents want to come together as community to do some reading, to have some sharing? Do we want to have a helpline where parents can call in to our counselors or teachers, talk about the situations that are emerging at homes, because we're also an inclusive school, and we find for a lot of special children, children with various conditions, this is something they're unable to make meaning of. And they're finding it very difficult, cooped in their apartments the whole time. That's true. That is leading to some kind of challenging behaviors which families are struggling with. So we're really available for parents. And I think what has been most valuable for us is really the one-on-one conversations, for which we've been available as teacher community with parents. We've also found the power of storytelling. For instance, we have a healing story for the kindergarten children about this little gnome who's stuck in a tree and who cannot go out to smell the flowers or to feel the wind, and who's constantly asking Mother Tree, when can I go and when can I go? And Mother Tree says, soon you will be free, but not now. And this is a beautiful image for children that, yes, right now I feel that I can't go into the garden or the play area, but soon you will be. So it's a beautiful healing story for children, which we've sent to parents, asking them to read for the children. So at the moment, our engagement is really working with the parents so that they are able to anchor their children. And that's where we've begun the work.
Okay, so now let us shift the focus onto the parent and the child. Okay, so I would like you to elaborate a bit on how social and emotional learning is to be encouraged now within the family setup. Because what has happened is parents are suddenly being put in a different role. There was a stage which was evolving worldwide in last 10-15 years that parents had a kind of, you know, outsourced the bringing of their child to the teachers and the school. Now suddenly there is a stop to that. And the parents will have to go into real parenting perhaps in a big way. So what kind of activities and intervention you would suggest that the families bring in with respect to the child, so that the child comes out much stronger after this episode?
I think it's a very important question, Amol, what you're just putting in front of both of us. And I think before we even come into the question of well-being, I want to attend to a question that sits before that point, which is the question of fear. And I think a lot of transactional conversations, many families have been very good at. The media has been very good at, which is to tell the children that they have to wash their hands, they have to eat healthy, perhaps have a lot of herbal remedy and so on to build their immunity, to maintain social distances. So I think these transactional conversations are very important. They're needed for the times. And I think as families, we are perhaps doing a very good job at it. But I want to come to the question of what about the psychological? For instance, if a child were to hear the number of people that are dying, which sometimes news has its own dragon ways of penetrating into the lives of children. And much as we want to protect them from it, what does it mean for the child? You know, I recall a situation where as a school, we were engaged with packing relief material for the children and displaced homes in Chennai, which is close by from where we live, during the floods 2 years ago. And when we were just done with this task, there was a group of children sitting there and one boy looking at me and asking me, you know, will we have floods in Coimbatore? Okay. And, you know, that's a moment for me to realize that for the children, what is so important is, especially children under 12 years of age, am I safe? Will I die? Will I be alive tomorrow? Will my mother and father die? And these are their most important questions that perhaps, you know, they're living with. So I think the first place in emotional well-being is to really be in conversation with our children on the psychological well-being. Mm-hmm. You know, what do you know of this disease? And what are your fears? Do you worry sometimes? Will you ever be able to go to school? Recently, a mother asked me, you know, I know that I'm unable to predict if school will ever open or not. Mm-hmm. And when my child asks me, when will I go to school? It would be a lie if I said in 2 weeks or 4 weeks. So what is moral and ethical? What is right to tell them? Much as we don't know what is really the future, I think to tell a child, I don't know and nobody knows, is a disservice. Because that then leaves the child with a real mood of despair. My mother and father, who know everything in this world, don't know when life will be life again. It's a very frightening picture for the child. So much as we don't know, I think it's important to say soon enough. We don't know what that soon means. And I really want to close with this one story that's like very special to me, a story of this Polish doctor, Janusz Korczak. And he was in an orphanage with 193 children. And one night he gets this message that the next morning he needs to take his 193 children and walk to the ghetto in Treblinka, which means they are going there to be perished forever. And that night after dinner, he calls the children and he tells them, children, tomorrow morning we will go on a little walk, perhaps like a little walk in the garden, and we will all wear our best clothes. Mm-hmm. Just imagine the intention and the courage of this doctor. Mm-hmm. And the children wear their best clothes and the doctor in the front and walking, perhaps with a song in their lips and joy in their hearts. And where they went to was the ghetto to be perished forever. It's a very moving story of optimism, of hope, of courage, of joy, even in the time of total darkness. And I want to leave this image with all of us as caregivers, parents, educators, that much as we hold the stones in our heart, what we can give the children is a picture of hope, is a picture of life again and joy.
So the focus now shifts again to the parent, right?
Yes.
So have you by any chance opened up any helpline for your parents?
Yes, in fact, that has been the most meaningful amount for us, that we as a school said that teachers mental health workers are available really for parents for conversations, to really talk to them about what's bothering them, what's living with them, what are their challenges, and how can they, despite all of that, be available for their children? And that's been a very meaningful effort. That's from our school. And I understand from you what you have been engaged with in the last few weeks. And for me, it's really something that I'm yet to grasp. And I know that, you know, you are a believer of technology, of course, mindful use of technology. And I know that you're spearheading this work in the Middle East. And perhaps Singapore and many other places with your schools in terms of connecting and using technology as a tool to take the school into the life of the child, into their living rooms and bedrooms and into their homes and hearts. It must have been an enormous experience, and I'm really curious to understand from you, what has it been like?
Yeah, it's very interesting question, Sandhya, because, you know, when the life is going as normal, or it remains exciting, when things are happening in your life which are very exciting, you tend to ignore some of the basic facts in life. I'm talking from point of view of an expat. Okay. What generally happens in the life of an expat is you are immediately, most likely, cut off from your extended family. Okay, so your safety net is weak as it is, because you don't have anyone else to fall back upon in case of difficulty or a crisis. Also, in the life of the child, therefore, school and teacher plays a very important part, because distance has weakened the wisdom bridges, as Revard Dajji so very rightly highlights. So teacher and school plays a very important role. It's not a mere building, especially in Middle East or in South Asia, places like Singapore or in Europe. School is just not a building. It's an infrastructure around which the child builds his or her life, makes friends, learns how to socialize, how to build social contacts. The entire social learning and the emotional learning for a child, especially for an expat, happens in the school. What happened in Middle East was, suddenly we were told that from 5th of March, the schools will be closed. And then the regulator announced that from 22nd March, entire learning goes online. Now we are in the middle of our annual exams. The Indian schools were in the middle of annual exams. We still conducted annual exams online. So that was the first experience for many families to test how technology can help bridge the deficit or gap that is suddenly created. So technology came out as a big enabler. Luckily for us, we had the right infrastructure for IT in place. UAE has a good IT infra as such as a country. There were some challenges with a few families, because they were not having adequate hardware with them. Because some families are large, 3, 4, 5 children, and you won't have those many hardware devices at home. So again, teachers had to calibrate their working. So schools, including my school, have started evening classes. Okay, so the school is actually happening for some sections in the evening. Otherwise, it works as a normal school for all the global schools which we operate here in Middle East. Initially, there were challenges for the teachers also, because you have to understand that the teachers and the pedagogy and the learning plans that you have for each class are fine-tuned for face-to-face interaction. Suddenly, that face-to-face presence was not there. It was all virtual. Many of the teachers were also not initially mentally equipped. So, but we found them extremely adaptive, and they really adapted themselves quickly to the changed scenario. And that was a big plus for us. But the larger plus was the parents. You know, any virtual or distance learning program will only work if the parent create the right kind of ecosystem at home. Congratulations to all the parents of global schools and many other parents in UAE and elsewhere. They quickly created the right kind of ambience and the ecosystem for the children to settle down into online learning. So even though for 1 or 2 weeks there was a break in conversation between teacher and the child, quickly the children realized that this is a new way of connecting with each other. And then we have found that they have quickly extended it towards their families back home in their respective countries. So parents are now confirming to us that the old connections are revived. You know, it takes a tragedy sometimes to revive old connections in life.
Yeah.
So this was a tragedy which people have converted into the most potent and positive opportunity. And overall, the response has been good. Technology has come across as a savior. And the initial fear that people will become slave of technology are perhaps found to be little bit untrue. We still recommend that we limit the display time or screen time for a child. So the daily timetable has been structured in such a manner that a child on an average spends about 30-40 minutes in front of the screen and has 20-25 minutes of break or a change of activity, so that, you know, there is no physical damage to the body by, you know, constantly sitting in one position and one place, and you get enough time to do all the other activities around the house. So overall, it's a good experience so far. But the real challenge comes next, because we are only in the middle of April.
Yes.
And the schools will now physically open for us in Middle East. As of now, the timeline is September.
Yeah.
So we still have 4 months and some days before the children actually walk in
to the school.
Into the school. Okay.
Yeah.
And they can't even go back because their home countries are closed.
Yes.
Okay. So they'll be closeted in the house. Many of the buildings and localities are being isolated. To, just to ensure that the disease doesn't spread. So basically the family and the child is within the four walls.
Yeah.
And parents are also working.
Yes.
We have started seeing economic impact of the situation.
Yeah.
So in coming weeks and months, the economic imbalance will also come into play.
Yeah.
So the entire family unit as such, and the child especially, the resilience and the character and the tenacity of the entire family unit is perhaps going to be tested. That is where I feel the schools have to play a very large part.
Yeah, absolutely.
All those who can afford to give time to others. This is actually, you know, Sandhya, time to give.
Yes, absolutely.
And I honestly see a lot of people coming forward, you know. Those days are gone where when people, especially in the kind of world we live in, UAE or Middle East,
yeah,
everything was transactional.
Yeah.
And suddenly I realized that it is not so, for many people are coming forward.
Yes.
And you know, offering their own voluntary services so that they can interact with the children and young families.
Absolutely.
And people have realized the value of giving.
Absolutely.
Giving whatever you are able to, a little bit here and there, doesn't, the quantum is not important. It is, yeah, the spirit and the intention and the emotion and the feeling, yeah, which comes across, that is important. So absolutely. I think all in all, society is putting the best foot forward.
Yeah.
Families are gearing up. They are also ensuring that everything remains safe.
Yes.
You know, from society, it has come down to the family. It has now come back to the child.
Yeah.
And as our heartfulness masters have so very regularly, spoken of.
Yeah.
If we take corollary and hint from there, the healing really will start from the child.
Yes. I wish to ask you a question, Amol, at this point in time. Sorry, yeah, to interrupt you here. You know.
Just to tell you, we are likely to have a little guest on the,
yes,
meeting now.
Yeah.
So, but you can ask your question.
Yeah. Before this guest comes, just a moment to ask you this question, that I know that you're a passionate educator, but I know that you're even more passionate about this practice that we're all on, the meditation, heartfulness meditation. Or for that matter, any form of meditation or a prayer life. And at this time, times like this, where we're surrounded by a certain dark mood and feeling, I think each one of us are united in our striving to find the light within. I wish for you to just say something, even if it is brief, about this journey, just at the cusp of inviting this little guest into our fold.
You know, for Sandhya, for any person to choose a lifestyle,
yeah,
is always a trigger.
Okay. Yeah.
That trigger came to me very early when I had just done my grade 12 and joined the engineering college. And the person who was merit number one in the state, in the first year, he flunked. He flunked in four subjects. Okay. And thereafter, we were watching him that he just disappeared in the background. He was never his own self. Afterwards, it took him quite a few years to gather the pieces together and build his own life. And that gave me a first jerk in my life, introspecting on which I realized that academics and looking at academics is only a single dimensional approach to life. You need to be much more than that. And that is where your social skills, how you cope up with sudden stress or sudden uncertain situation, how you build your own personality with respect to empathy and kindness, how you strengthen your own resolve, how you become more tenacious, how you build your own resilience. Of course, the situation and incidents in life will help you become more resilient, but you need to take the right kind of learning. Therefore, I realized at some stage when I was in college that I need to have a different lifestyle, a way of life. Okay. And then I started scouting. I went to Ramakrishna Mission, which was very near to my place in Nagpur. Started reading a lot of literature of Vivekananda. Started with complete works. And at some stage, through a close relative of mine, I heard about heartfulness. I had the option of joining a company in Bangalore and Mumbai, but I didn't want to go into a big city. I don't know why, I never thought I should go to a big city early in my life, because I didn't want to lose myself in the hullabaloo of a city. So I went to Pune without any job in hand, you know, declining those two jobs, one in Bangalore and one in Mumbai, and started looking for a job. So 2-3 months, I didn't have anything to do. That is when I started my experimentation with heartfulness. And I'm deliberately saying experimentation with heartfulness because it took me almost 7 years, 8 years to really come into mainstream. I started heartfulness in 1985 and I experimented. I even gave it a chance that stay away for some time and see what happens. But I found myself going back to it again for several reasons. Main reason being, it didn't demand anything from me. It just demanded that I be a good human being. Okay. And the entire onus was on me to do my practice. And honestly speaking, I don't think I have lost anything in life thereafter. Whatever has come to me has always been good, deserving. I never had to run and snatch and fight for anything, because heartfulness taught me to work hard and leave the fruits at the doorstep of your guru. I have done that honestly and sincerely. And this is where I am.
Thank you for
still
that.
Smiling sharing. Under the circumstances and yeah. Happy inside. That's more important for me. Yeah. Money will come and go. That's not important. But happiness, the wealth inside me, as my master has taught me, will remain with me. And we do a lot of experimentation, therefore, in our schools with heartfulness. Both my campuses do heartfulness relaxation every day at the start of the day. Idea is that the child, when he or she reaches the school after 1 hour journey, because you know Middle East, they travel a lot in the morning and in the evening when they go to the school and come back home. So we want the child to be very grounded and fresh when the school starts. So all the children do heartfulness relaxation and little bit of school prayer for about 15 minutes. And then they go into regular learning process.
Thank you.
So Sandhya, we discussed a lot today. And what we discussed was family is important. But the most important person in all this game for you and me is the child. So we also discussed about various interventions and various practices that the family should practice, and especially the child can be introduced to. So I have a wonderful small guest for you. Her name is Saraswati. Hello, Saraswati.
Hello, uncle.
So Sandhya, Saraswati is an 8-year-old child from Dubai and has been practicing heartfulness for last several years. She does heartfulness relaxation very regularly. And recently the Children's Center of Middle East has started a new program called Sharing is Caring. Okay. Where the child is the focus to connect to the parents and the children of the world through their heart, and then the feelings are transmitted to the parents as well as children of the world. So if you are a game, then we can have Saraswati to take us through the process.
Yes, of course. Wonderful to meet you, Saraswati.
Thank you, Auntie.
And it's so special to have you here, because until you arrived here, me and Amol uncle, we've been talking about children. And to just see you just fills my heart. Thank you for being here.
Okay, Saraswati. So it's all up to you now to take us through relaxation and sharing is caring. Talk can a bit loudly, okay? Just be a bit.
Can I start?
Go.
Good morning, uncles and aunties, and my dear brothers and sisters. Are you all ready to share and care with me today?
Yes.
Yes. Before we start, let's relax our body by following simple suggestions. Let's start. Sit comfortably and close your eyes gently. Let's begin with the toes. Wiggle your toes and feel them relax. Relax your ankles and feet. Feel the energy move up from the earth to your knees, relaxing the legs. Relax your thighs. Feel the energy move up from your legs, relaxing them. Deeply relax your hips, stomach, and waist. Relax your back from the top to the bottom. Feel your entire back is relaxed. Relax your chest and shoulders. Feel your shoulders simply melting away. Relax your upper arm, forearm, your hands, right up to your fingertips. Relax your neck muscles. Move your awareness up to your face. Relax your jaws, mouth, eyes, nose, earlobes, facial muscles, forehead, all the way to the top of your head. Move your attention to your heart. Rest there for a little while. Feel immersed in the love and warmth in your heart. Remain still and quiet and slowly become absorbed into yourself. Now, connect heart to heart with all the children in the world. Imagine all the children are sitting in front of us. Now, share the feeling of togetherness and hope. Let's share and care for 3 minutes or more.
That's all. Thank you, Saraswati. You were so
thank
kind
you,
and lovely.
Thank you, Uncle.
So, how does it feel, Sandhya?
It's wonderful. Yeah.
Look, sometimes we don't realize that when a child is born, we bring the child in our future. Okay. But at some stage, the child starts defining his or her own future, and we walk as parents into their future.
Yes.
And therefore, I firmly believe that it is the future of children like Saraswati,
yeah,
which we'll find ourselves walking into,
yeah,
as we grow old. And therefore, the charge of driving the future has to be given to them. And heartfulness does that beautifully by engaging with children. If we ensure that the children get exposure to the right kind of practices,
yeah,
so I think Saraswati,
such a healing energy that you could feel being
the healing
on the
will
left
have
chain,
to happen
as we could
through
imagine
the child.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
Because the last person affected in the entire disruption process is the child, and then the healing will start from there. And their innocence, their naturalness, their energy, their positive intent. You know, children are always full of hope, always,
yes,
generally.
Absolutely.
That needs to be, you know, expanded further so that they can in turn go back and heal the family and go forward again and heal the society.
You know, we've spoken so much about children, and the energy is filled with really intentions for children. And I brought a small piece to read as we could close today, which is an imaginative picture,
mm-hmm,
for children. And I wish to read this before we can say farewell. It's called A Recipe for Preserving Children. And the ingredients are one large grass field, 6 children, a dozen dogs, duck, puppies, kittens and such, a narrow strip of brook with lots of pebbles, hot sun, flowers, deep blue sky. And the method to cook: mix the children, the dogs, puppies and kittens and such, empty them into the grass field, pour the brook and pebbles, mix well, sprinkle the field with flowers, cover with deep blue sky, bake it in the hot sun, and when cool, serve them with warm milk and hot cookies. And I think this is such a beautiful imaginative picture of childhood. And I really wish that we carry this beautiful imaginative picture and an intention for the sunshine again, for all
we
of us
must,
and for the
we
children.
Must hope for sunshine and happiness.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely.
So, that was wonderful, Sandhya and Saraswati. And Sandhya, I hope we have more such conversations with each other.
Okay. Yes, I do too.
I wish
thank
you
Thank you, Saraswati. And thank you, Amol.
Pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Yeah.